Why would you celebrate the slowly tightening grip of death?
We'll be right back. doing well. Would you mind introducing yourself for the microphone?
I'm Mark Rudolph. I'm an illustrator. I used to be a podcaster, but I'm way delinquent on that. And I draw stuff for bands and magazines and concerts and Decibel and Metal Hammer.
This podcast that you speak about, how would people have known about it?
The Requiem Metal Podcast was, we ran for probably, I don't know how many years we ran for. You probably might know better than me, I'm not sure, if you found your notes. But, me and Jason Hundey did a podcast for a number of years that was kind of our, it was like our answer to an NPR version of metal conversation, where we just kind of take a topic, a band, a scene, an era, and just talk about it for about an hour, and very like radio show-like, where we talk, have little segments of us talking, and then couple songs, come back, talk about it, you know, that kind of thing. That was the podcast.
Would you say it was very much like Car Talk?
It was Car Talk for metalheads, yes. I forgot our old pitch, yes.
People who listen to this podcast may or may not know that the inspiration for the Dreams of Consciousness podcast was actually Requiem. And Dreams of Consciousness actually started around the time that Requiem started posting less and less. And I found myself with lots of time to kill, so I decided that the voice I most wanted to hear talk about metal was my own.
Yes, exactly. I understand. I appreciate that. That's very... There's been like three or four podcasts that have been right, that have we've inspired, which is very humbling. And we just sought out to just talk about, we was two guys that really love to talk about metal, but we don't just like to talk about it. We want to make a project out of it somehow. It started out in the early, like 1990, 91. Me and Chris Dick started the Requiem magazine, fanzine, photocopied fanzine that ran for a number of years, maybe 6 years, I think. And then maybe 2005, the timeline I'm totally off on. But into the 2000s, the podcast almost became like another. It's when me and Jason kind of started listening to other shows. It was like maybe we can do something like a zine version of an audio version of a zine or something to try to get our enthusiasm for heavy metal and whatever other random crap we'd end up talking about in a given episode, be it like, you know, his history background as a teacher, bringing that into talking about metal, or my artistic, you know, art background, bringing it into it, and been following the scene since I was 14 years old, you know, when it started, kind of thing. So I don't know if that answers the questions. I was trailing off there for a while.
So was Jason part of the zine as well?
He was part of the Eclipse magazine, which Chris Dick started up a couple years after that, which was actually, it was a different kind of model. It was a free magazine. It was paid by advertising. And then we would like give it away to, like say like Relapse and Century Media Distro would give it away with orders and things like that. Or we would go to shows, you know, like it was the old Milwaukee Metal Fest, and we'd set up a table and sell zines and barely make any money on it and that kind of stuff. But yeah, Jason was a writer for that magazine, and I got onto it on the third issue. I took over the art direction on that when I was in college and doing like experimental photography stuff and like trying to tweak the covers up to make them look more depressing and like old Catatonia record covers, or you know, whatever, just to try to follow the kind of trends in the visual art of, you know, album covers at that point, try to bring that into the magazine and make it less we didn't want it to be as like standard stock Time Magazine Newsweek-y kind of look, to try to bring a more, I don't know, more rich aesthetic look to fanzines. Stuff that we wanted to see, basically. That's how we started everything, was like, we saw fanzines, we're like, these aren't, like, they're okay, they're not to shit on them or anything, but they're okay, but what do we want to see in a magazine? And that's what we've always been trying to do. That's what I try to do with my art now, and just be a fan. And try to be a part of, because I'm not a musician, but to be part of that scene. That's because it's incredibly important to me. Yeah, you know, it's my entire professional life has been that, surprisingly.
Did you do interviews and reviews like a normal zine?
Oh yeah, yeah. We used to we had the old microcassette recorders, and we'd like get a hold of, most of the time it was either by telephone or actually like, I remember interviewing Dismember in like 1990, it might have been 93, like. Man, like we had really weird expectations, because we never interviewed a foreign person before. It was like, is a Swedish guy gonna be hard to understand? Is it gonna be like Muppets sounding, or is it like, are we gonna? It's, you know, just stupid shit. Growing up in the Midwest, we were kind of like insulated. We didn't know anything about other cultures, really.
I mean, it was a much different time because this was pre-internet for most of us. So, you know, how did you get the contact information for these bands?
Basically, a lot of it was like getting the demos. We'd get the demos. We did. Chris was more involved in it than I was, but in the whole tape trading scene, everybody would have a list, and like most of those, when you'd get the demos, they'd have the address of whoever it might be. You know, Scott Carlson from Impulsion, here's his P.O. box in Flint. Send him a handwritten letter, like, hey, we really think you're cool, maybe the next show we're at, can we maybe get an interview with you? Or, you know, like Dismember, we set it up through Nuclear Blast America, which was a part of Relapse at the time, and just set up with their PR guy, like, oh, you're going to go back and talk to Matty Carkey for 45 minutes. And we were just scared to death, but as soon as you get over that fear of meeting, you know, these like larger than life, they're just guys. They love it as much as you do, and they don't want to be treated any differently. Like, I met Greg from Paradise Lost and Valenfire last night, and he did a little piece in my Morbid Tales book, the illustrated tribute to Celtic Frost. And I showed him the picture, just very casually, like kind of Albert from Decibel introduced me to him, and he was eating some lunch back here at the VIP area. And saw the picture that I drew of him and just spit some food out laughing because he liked it so much. I was like, okay, off to a great start. But meeting really humble, down-to-earth heroes like that is, that's what makes the whole, where everybody's just got, like, we're working on this whole thing together. There's no division between fan and, you know, and people on stage, except for, well, some obvious things, but yeah.
with communication being the way it was back then, like sending off a letter, waiting for the reply to come back, how many issues were you able to put out in a year?
One. It was about, the first issue was, I think, 70, maybe 78 pages or 84 pages. Most of the interviews, we either recorded them and transcribed them, or a lot of them, I remember getting hold of the band, Jesus, what were they even called now? Well, Cyanide, we did one through the mail. Like, we'd just send them a list of questions, and then they'd just send them back to us. Resurrection, an old Florida death metal band, was the funniest one, because I sent the questions out, and they're all one-word responses. And we still ran it, because it's like, well, I get still an interview, I guess. We wrote, like, a little paragraph, like, aping all the stuff that the PR person would put in their press release, then kind of rewording it in our own way. And then, like, here, what's your biggest influence? It's like, blah, blah, blah. It's like, duh. So it was hit and miss. But then sometimes you'd get ones with, trying to think of some of the right-away ones. There were some, though, that you were really surprised. You got, like, pages and pages of handwritten responses back, which is fantastic. But it was an incredible amount of work. But when you're, you know, 17, 18 years old, you got nothing but time on your hands. So we ended up, you know, befriending guys at Kinko's and buying him pizzas for him to let us to turn his back, and we go back and print stuff for free and all that kind of stuff. It was great. That's how I met most of my long-term friends, is by other people that are doing the same type of stuff. Just bored kids that grew up in smaller towns or bigger towns, but just kind of instant, like, we had a handful of people that even knew what anything outside of Sepultura was. Like, Arise kind of blew up when I was in high school, or last year of high school, I think. But as far as, like, you know, Death and Morbid Angel and Bolt Thrower and all that stuff, there was, like, a handful of us that were into it. So it was like, as soon as we met somebody that was into it, we're just like, hey, roll them into the fray. Can you write it all? Like, just tell us. We'll try to fix. My mom was, she was a teacher, an elementary school teacher for years. So I could say, like, here's my Dismember interview. Like, where should I put commas? And, you know, that kind of stuff. But, yeah, anybody that had enthusiasm, that we had. The first issue was more enthusiasm than anything good or any kind of creative content, but we were incredibly enthusiastic about it. So.
And what kind of reaction did you get from people who read the zine or bought the zine?
It was a different time, so it was more, you couldn't go online and say, like, I want a review of the new Deicide record and, like, see it right away. It was more, stuff would trickle in. It was, we'd meet people at shows, and they're like, oh, yeah, you guys from, you know, the Requiem or whatever. I don't even remember how many we sold. Maybe the first issue we might have printed under 100 copies, I'm sure. And we sold all of them. The only copy I've got right now has an autograph from Jean-Christ, what the hell is his name, DeCroyer from Gorefest. I don't have a clean copy of the first issue anymore. So it's got Gorefest signatures all over the thing, but. Yeah, so it was just basically through shows. We get letters once in a while. A lot of the time, it was other guys that did zines, and we trade and kind of start a relationship that way. And it took, you know, a handful of issues to get any kind of active response or if anybody even knew. Like, there's no echo chamber. It was just, you threw it out in the ether, and if something came back, it was like throwing, shipping a, you know, a letter in a bottle kind of thing. And if it came back, cool. If not, like, okay, at least some guy liked it and sent us a letter, so we'll do the next one. We would have done it without any feedback from anybody at that point.
Was there a long lag between when you stopped doing the zine and when you started doing the podcast?
There was, because Requiem, the years I'm foggy on, but we probably did it like about 5 years for the Requiem. I took a couple years off and just got away from everything. Focused a little bit more on illustration and cartooning and stuff. And then in, I believe it was mid to late 90s, started doing the Eclipse magazine. And that ran for 7 years, into the early 2000s. It was a good 5 years, I think, in between, like, ending a zine and then doing that. And in that time, too, I worked at Relapse for a little while doing graphic design, and I worked on the Amorphous Elegy record and, like, Neurosis Through Silver and Blood and some stuff like that. So it was cool, but it wasn't something I wanted to do. And I found that was the point where I figured out that, you know, graphic design was cool, but I didn't want to do it for a living. Because once you get paid to do something you love, that's the test if you really love it enough to do it, or if it's like, eh, I need to get a day job and just work on this stuff I love, you know? So, yeah, there's just a little, maybe 4 or 5 years, something like that. If, I don't know, it's probably totally wrong, but that's what my memory remembers.
the thing that I liked most about the podcast, well, this honestly, I don't even remember how I, because I was listening to a lot of podcasts. I was listening to Mark Maron. I was listening to a bunch of comedy podcasts, and it never dawned on me that there might be a metal podcast. And I started to feel like I was falling behind, like there's stuff being released that I had no clue about. And so I just kind of like looked up like metal podcasts, and I came to Requiem. And as I was scrolling through the episodes, I was like, holy shit, these guys like Vader. Holy shit, these guys like Naglfar. But the actual selling point was Eucharist. Because like, I've been trying to tell my friends about Eucharist and been ignored for like, when did Mirror Worlds come out? That was like
96?
Something like that.
Yeah, because that whole, Jesus, what was that label? Yeah, Wrong Again Records, War Records.
Yeah.
When that stuff came out, it was like the second wave of the Gothenburg-y stuff with like Excretion, and the first Arch Enemy record still holds up as great, not whatever they turned in now. But yeah, Eucharist was a bizarre, really, and the selling point for Eucharist for us was they were like 14 years old when they recorded that first record. And it was those vocals are so brutal. And just everything about it was just bizarre and like off kilter. And it was like, that was kind of the era where like because we discovered Left Hand Path like a year after it came out, and like Autopsy right around that time, but that was kind of our thing we really grabbed onto and took ownership of because nobody else knew about it. Like we were ordering stuff through distros, you know, like sending IRCs and international money orders for huge amounts of money at the time, you know, working at Burger King and stuff. Like your entire paycheck could go to get a couple CDs or something. But yeah, sorry to cut you off about about Eucharist, but yeah, that was your jumping on point for
Requiem. Yeah. You guys also did like the entire Wrong Again Records compilation, right? Or one of them?
We did the first one, yeah.
Yeah.
The first. Go ahead. Yeah, well, that one, that was a weird, that was kind of like the holy grail of new stuff that nobody knew anything about. God, I'm trying to even think who's on it. Like Naglfar's on it. Eucharist, In Flames before they became the Slipknot-ish Korn kind of thing. Yes, Ceremonial Oath. Which the, I think, what is it? Is it The Truth or The Book? Or The Book of Truth?
I think it was,
it was Carpet Era.
Yeah.
Which is a bizarre, but that was the era too when you could have bands like Furball and stuff that was just fucking weird, really weird stuff happening. But yeah, that Wrong Again Records thing, that was something that at least in our group of friends was kind of a huge deal that we were really surprised nobody else caught on to. Like bands like Dimension Zero that I thought were, they took all the good old elements of In Flames and like amped it up just faster, more aggressive, more everything. And that's the stuff that we really got stoked about. And I think people kind of figured it out years later, but it was so small, but so huge, you know, to us that we just had this like undying enthusiasm for it. Or like the Swedish band Dawn,
yes.
The Slaughter Son record,
oh my God.
Which is, you know, after, what is it, like 15 years since it came out or something or more. Like that's, people are like, wow, this is really groundbreaking. And nobody knew about it. It was on like Necropolis or something, you know, that's...
So, I mean, that pretty much sealed its fate, right?
Yeah.
It's on a Necropolis, and nobody heard about it, and it just kind of ended up in the landfill with, like, all the old E.T. Atari games.
Basically, hopefully not in the landfill, but, like, speaking of of Necropolis, Nebelich, is here tonight.
Okay.
At Maryland Death Fest. Or not tonight, but tomorrow. It's one of the, I think it's the first recorded Finnish death metal band with the burping vocals and all that stuff. And in 2015, I would have never expected, being a 40-year-old man, seeing Demolich play in the United States, which is kind of crazy. All this stuff is so weird, but the whole metal scene that I've been, like, there's people I've known for 20 plus years in this thing, and there's the casual people that just come out, but as far as people in the industry and podcast people, magazine people, it's so tight knit. I absolutely love it. I don't know any other scene that's that, I don't know, that has that kind of bond to it, really, you know.
I want to ask one last thing about the podcast, and then we'll move on to your art. How much of what you were doing was to give exposure to bands like Eucharist or like the War compilation bands that people didn't know about, and how much of it was just like it was stuff that you loved and you just want to talk about it?
It was mostly just stuff we love. Once in a while, like those, we did those like Crucial Years in Metal thing. That was more, Jason's a very...
He's a history teacher.
He's a history teacher, so he has his mind's like a trap. He can remember dates of everything, everybody's name. And I'm more of a gut instinct kind of, like, you know, I'm drawn to certain things, but I'll forget if I don't talk about it. Like, my mind starts to trail away because I like to just daydream and think about demons and monsters and all this terrible shit I draw all the time. But yeah, I think if I had to break it down, it's probably 90% of the shows are just like, well, sometimes it was, we don't have much time. What can we do no research on and talk about? Like, you know, the Entombed EPs episode that we did, that was a huge record for me. I listened to it constantly. I could talk ad nauseum about it. And Jade's like, okay, cool. So those are the ones I think were the most fun, was just where we just, okay, come up with a playlist really quick. We know we can, there's a lot to talk about, but it's doing those other more structured ones to break it up. Because I have a really terrible sense of guilt about a lot of stuff. I don't want to do a half-assed job on anything, so I want to give people something out of it. I don't want them just to like, oh, here's the throwaway episode that we didn't really, they phoned in or something. So yeah, it was mostly just out of pure love or ease of talking about the subject.
One last question about Requiem, and then we'll move on. Will there be more Requiem?
Me and Jason are talking right now. We want to do something that's a little bit more easier. He lives about 45 minutes away from me. We used to live together, which made things a lot easier. So we're in talks to try to do something that's a little bit more streamlined, not once a week, probably once a month, possibly putting them all out at once, trying like a Netflix model or something with it. But I want to try something where we put it out on iTunes, but also want to try Bandcamp and SoundCloud and a couple of those other things where you can actually, people can throw you a couple bucks here and there, because it takes money to do all this stuff, because we usually end up buying, I've never stolen MP3s anywhere. If we do a show about, you know, whoever it might be, I'm trying to think of the last one we bought a bunch of shit for. Even like when we did like a show about Napalm, I bought everything I didn't have, like EPs and all kinds of stuff. So it's, we want to try to, you know, support the bands, but have everything there. I want to see the liner notes, not rely on Metal Encyclopedia for everything. I want to see, that was the magic in when you were a kid, is flipping open those records and reading all that stuff and then making connections between, oh, Thomas Skogsberg did this and this and this and this, and Dan Seagrave did this cover and this cover and this cover kind of thing. So, yeah, I was starting to trail off a little bit, but we should see something, hopefully within the summer, like the late summer, we want to try to get something going again.
Breaking news.
Yes, yes, yes.
The words of truth are spoken. They all chant that there is in fear. the shadow then. We all come in our destiny. Silence the music, use my brain. A symphony by which my mind is free. Nocturnal treasure, lay beyond. Far beyond your reality. Shadow death, passing before my tortured eyes. Marching across the shadow sky. Storm rip the black and clouds. The shadow death. We'll be right back.
So let's talk about the art. I think a lot of people who listen to this podcast may also be familiar with you as the guy who does illustrations for Decibel. You do some of the illustrations that go along with the editorials and also with the reviews. Is that right?
Yeah, mostly it's the lead reviews. I was doing the back page, the South Pole Dispatch. I would do that every once in a while, but it's basically the lead reviews, the caricatures of metal people, which was starting that. Like Albert was just like, I visited him in back in Philly when he was working in the Philly offices, and Chris Dick introduced me to him, and I gave him a pile of comics that I'd done at the time. It was just all weird sci-fi, Twilight Zone-y kind of stuff, no caricature or anything. And a couple months later, he's like, "I got an idea for the lead. Like, instead of just having a photo for the lead review, we want to do something different. Do you want to try to do some kind of illustration for that?" And I was like, I was scared shitless, but I was also like, yeah, that'd be awesome. It was a really good challenge. And I've been doing being in that kind of avenue, like on that, having that kind of visibility and doing bad work is for me is terrifying. I want to try to put my best foot forward. So that first illustration I worked on for 2 weeks. Now they take me a day and a half maybe. But I just wanted to really put my best foot forward out there to show, because people at that point hadn't really, none of my art was associated with heavy metal at all, except for what I'd done back in the fanzines and, you know, when I was 18 years old or something, which is terrible. Speaking of 18 years old, real quick, as a little side thing, Dan Seagrave painted Altars of Madness when he was 18 years old, which makes me feel like a pile of crap, but it's also great. It's inspiring. Yeah, I've been chatting with him. It's really awesome to talk and to like talk shop with an artist of his caliber that's that low key and down to earth too. So, but so I've been doing that for Decibel. I've done a couple covers for him. I did the they do these special issues usually about once a year. I've done a death metal, black metal, doom issue, and they're all kind of. At first, Albert kind of was thinking of just me reinterpreting a couple different versions of, like, you know, Grave Into the Grave and Left Hand Path. And I was like, what if I do some kind of, like, collage, but I redraw everything in my style? He's like, great. Like, he's been really supportive and challenging, because that death metal cover took, God, I pulled out so many CDs. I had piles of CDs taken out of their, you know, the jackets all opened up, all these sketches of everything, and it took me probably a good, I mean, not total, but like working on it pretty diligently about a month to get the whole thing done. You know, it's a huge kind of like who's who or where's Waldo of like what album cover, like, you know, Autopsy, you know, there's a spiritual healing preacher and there's this and all that. And after I finished the whole thing, I was like, you know, it'd be kind of cool if we did like a who's who, like actually little dots saying what everything is, because people were trying to like guess that stuff. They're like getting into it. I was like, okay, let's keep this going. That's kind of been the thing with all of them going on. Like when I post it online or just people talking about it, like, oh shit, what was that one there? And like, oh, that was, you know, the cathedral ethereal mirror little bit there. So yeah, so Decibel was the big kind of. Within the last, the issue number, I started 152, I believe, and I think they're well over issued, I'm not even sure. Details escape me for the most part, but so I've been doing, I know, that's the tough part, but yeah, so I've been doing a lot of stuff for Decibel. I do a monthly illustration for Metal Hammer in the UK as well, where it's basically a kind of, they'll pick up, like, I've done some for Alice Cooper, or Johan from Amon Amarth, where it's just kind of like a little essay about a certain topic, and they'll then I just kind of do whatever, you know, they kind of give me carte blanche to do whatever there, and those are my main gigs. But there's a lot of periphery things like the books and.
Has a band ever contacted you about doing artwork from the Decibel Metal Hammer stuff?
Oh yeah, I did. Which was a dream come true for me. I did the last Carcass tour where they came through. I did their tour posters, and I did the picture disc art for the, what was it? It was like a tour exclusive of Surgical Steel. Did t-shirt designs and all that stuff for them. So I've done a lot of that. I've done stuff recently for Broken Hope, for Coalesce, Battle Cross, a bunch of other ones that I'm forgetting that are probably pretty a big deal, but I can't think about it right now. But yeah, so that's really gotten me my foot in the door. And to work on these, the tribute books that I've been doing, the Satan is Alive, the Merciful Fate book, and the one that just came out this year, Morbid Tales, a tribute to Celtic Frost, are just illustrated. It's an illustrated tribute record to these bands. So I get cartoonists, I get different musicians to give me quotes, and I kind of like illustrate them or do like little caricatures of them, just telling me why it was important to them. Like I had Trevor Perez from Obituary did a little piece, Greg from Balanfire and Paradise Lost, Dan Lilker, a handful of other people did some stuff. So I've got enough cachet where I can contact people to say, hey, I'm Mark from Decibel and Metal Hammer, would you like to do a little thing here? So I've used all those contacts, this years of cultivating, to make these books, which people seem to like to dig. You know, there's like a mix of comics, a little bit of like history writing in the things, lots of humor about them, because as much as I love death metal and extreme metal and black metal, I love a sense of humor about it, because if you take anything too seriously, you become crazy, I think. Everything's got to have a slightly lighter side to it. You don't have to be like a pungent stench about your humor, but at least have a sense of humor about, like, the best example is Paradise Lost. Like, Nick Holmes from Paradise Lost, the singer, writes the most morose and morbid stuff ever. Like, just depressing, terrible shit. And then when you hear an interview or talk to him, he is the most like wisecracking guy ever. Like, there's a really good balance there between extreme. If you don't have a sense of humor about extreme metal and black metal, all this stuff, you're a sociopath, psychopath. Like some of these skinhead guys that run around and want to beat the shit out of people in a pit, or the people that are just sitting there headbanging and whatever. You know, weekend warrior guys. So.
I mean, speaking of the Paradise Lost guys, both of them played yesterday in different bands, and they're both ridiculously dryly funny. The guitarist with Valenfire was like, it's always been our dream to play a parking lot in Baltimore, and here we are living the dream in a car park in Baltimore. did you pick Mercyful Fate and Celtic Frost? Other than the fact that they're Mercyful Fate and Celtic Frost.
Mercyful Fate, I think, is one of the most visually evocative as far as like lyrical content goes. Because like in those books, some of the books, there's like, I would say, hey, would you want like get a hold of a cartoonist or an artist? Like, do you want to reinterpret these lyrics visually? And just looking at all their lyrics, it was like, you could write Hammer horror movies based on all this stuff. And like King Diamond always, he's always talks about how much of a, like kind of a storyteller he is. All of his albums have like certain like reoccurring characters and very, very thought out stuff, like way more than I would have ever thought. And I was just talking to a friend of mine, a fellow cartoonist, Tom Neely, who did the Henry and Glenn Forever series. And he's doing like the Humans, a comic for Image right now. I was talking to him at a convention and just, we were just kind of brainstorming about stuff. He's like, why don't you do that? I was like, because I already had some really rough kind of sketches of what I thought I wanted to do for it. And then he just like, yeah, I have all those options. He's like, yeah, why don't you use all these options to try to get this thing going? And it just kind of blew up. Nobody said no when I asked him. And even, yeah, Eric from Wotan, as cynical as he can kind of be, gave us a little quote for that. And then he gave us a quote for the Morbid Tales book, who was all, it was a little jabby about it. He's like, you know, like black metal's more serious than this, but, you know, he's got to have his image. I understand. But those, that Mercyful Fate, it was the just right off the bat imagery thing. Like King Diamond is super theatric. King Diamond and Mercyful Fate in general, just super theatrical bands. And I just thought that would be a great. The thing, it's also a band that I wanted to discover more about, because I knew about them, but I didn't know like everything I could possibly learn about them. So these are also, it's almost like it's similar to the podcast where I want to just talk about, I want to discover, dig into this certain band like really deeply. Watch every YouTube video I can find, read every interview, listen to the music over and over, the demos, like all kind of, everything I can possibly find. And then Celtic Frost, I think they're the most important extreme metal band ever, because they were that weird, they didn't, they're like more so than Venom. Venom is good. I love their music, but they were just, yeah, two records. Cast in Stone was okay, because I got to see the original lineup again in 97. That was really sweet. But they, I mean, they're just more of like, it was just punk, it was noisy, there wasn't anything different. Hellhammer and Celtic Frost and Triptychon doesn't sound like anybody. It's never sounded like anybody. It's always been about, it's been incredibly simple. It's catchy, it's dark. I don't know, I just think they're like one of the cornerstones of extreme, like, dark thrash to, you know, the metal spectrum.
I mean, similar to what you're saying about King Diamond, there's a very strong concept behind what Tom Warrior does.
Absolutely.
From an illustration sense, it's like, you know, you can really lock onto it and find a lot of things to do.
Well, his, yeah, I mean, his childhood is just like, it's so sad, but also like just, it's almost like a fairy tale. And when I was reading all this stuff up about him, watching some, there's a couple good documentaries on YouTube about him as well. Kind of the whole reformation of Celtic Frost, and then they, you know, blew up or whatever again. But, you know, him growing up by himself, like a latchkey kid, his mom was like a petty thief kind of thing. He was by himself constantly. Music was his first, you know, kind of salvation. And like books and, you know, astronomy and astronauts, all this stuff was like really super interesting to him. And that kind of struck a chord with me, because I grew up, you know, I grew up in the country. I was a pretty solitary kid. And I would just get real into stuff. Like that was, I'd rather be surrounded by books and music than people necessarily. So it was that kind of drew me to it. But his whole childhood was just cater made to try to turn into some kind of almost like parable, you know? And I did like a 24 something, almost maybe 30 page kind of, you know, of course, let it stretch a lot. It's not by any means like historically accurate, but I was trying to get all the, like the little things of him being a kid, discovering Venom, discovering the Beatles, and just that. What's that? No, the opposite order actually. But yeah, discovering like this particularly George Harrison songwriting really, you know, struck a chord with him, and just taking that, showing a little bit of him being like, you know, ridiculed as a kid, and how music kind of blew up his world and changed it, and do the stuff with Tony Iommi and Kronos coming in and bequeathing him, you know, guitars, and it's goofy, but it's me trying to throw out my love letter to Celtic Frost, basically.
In addition to those two books, you've also been doing comic books fairly regularly, right? I remember a while back you did the H.P. Lovecraft, what was it, Dagon?
Yes, yeah, the adaptation of Dagon. That was, God, I think that was 2011. It's been a while. I've done a handful. There's a band out of, I'm going to forget where they're from now, but there's a metal band called Green Death, like Iowa, I believe that where they're from. But I just did like a 24-page comic for them. I do a lot of just random freelance comic stuff. Nick's Comics out of Columbus, I do some stuff for them. It's like a music-related anthology. So do stuff. I do, what was his name? Not going to remember, but it was a prominent blues musician. I did like a little one-page thing about him. They were kind of like these, did they really happen kind of things. So I do these like little one-page kind of like gag strips about that. But mostly, comic-wise, I haven't done much lately just because I'm not bored, but I haven't found the right project to go into. Because it's a lot, I mean, that Dagon project was several months. I was unemployed, and I just gotten dumped by somebody that I liked, and it was just, instead of like wallowing in my misery, I just sat there and did that book. I was like, I'm gonna adapt something. I want some source material. I want to adapt it. Let's do that. It took a couple months, but I haven't found that next project. I've got a barbarian story that I've been wanting to do for a long time. I'm a lifelong Conan fan, so I want to try to do something like that with a little more 70s post-apocalyptic social commentary, you know, thing into it. But that's still a little ways off.
Is there anything you've got coming out soon that you can that we can look out for?
Well, we do have, this is the first Corpse Flower Records, a friend of mine in Detroit who's put out the Morbid Tales book. We're doing actually an LP of covers of Celtic Frost songs. I did all the art for, and I was the guy that kind of curated all the bands on it. It's got a local Detroit band, Childbite, with Phil Anselmo doing vocals, doing the Usurper, which we heard tonight. Acid Witch is on there. Scott Kelly from Neurosis is doing a side project thing. For this, we've got Municipal Waste is on it. A great doom band from Detroit, Temple of Void, is on it. It's a real different mixture of a lot of stuff. We got Scott Carlson from Repulsion did another side project specifically for this as well. So it's super exciting. It's like using all my favors that I ever had out there. Like, let's get this thing together, you know?
So years after you interviewed Scott Carlson for the zine, you guys are still in touch and still working on stuff together.
Yeah. I've talked to him on the telephone. It's great. He's the most down-to-earth, wonderful guy out there. Him and Matt from Repulsion, both those guys are just fantastic. Both helped me out with this the zine as well. And I was over the moon when Scott's like, oh, yeah, I'd love to do something. Is it okay if I do two things? I was like, you can do as many things as you want. We'll figure it out. So there's going to be it's going to be just a 12-inch record with a download code, and we're also going to have a flexi disc inside, like Decibel does, of Scott Carlson's band doing, Jesus, why can't I remember the name of the song? They're doing a Hellhammer track. I'll leave it at that. It'll be a little bit of a surprise. Excellent. It's been lots long weekend of screaming for me. So, so that should be out hopefully within the next couple months.
Excellent. And for people who want to get in touch with you and see more of your artwork and maybe order your books, how can they do that?
It's as easy as markrudolph.com.
You're also doing a comic book podcast too, right?
I did.
Yeah.
I did years ago.
Oh, okay.
So. It's still up, but that's the content's super, super old. It's artandstory.com. It's still up there if you want to check it out. Well over 200 episodes. There's thousands of hours of content on there. And that's just, that's something I did before I started the Requiem podcast. But, yeah, it's all still there. That's the great thing about the internet. Everything is available to you. You just got to find it.
Is there anything you want to add?
Thank you so much. I'm so stoked to like go back and check out some more of your podcasts now, and I really appreciate your enthusiasm and support over the years, and it's been great to catch up with you too.
Yeah, excellent. Thank you so much, Mark.
Hail Satan, I submit to the dark side.